Kembo, Kembo, Natata Nzambi Amazulu, in the holy name of Isaiah Kongo, our powerful king, Isaiah, who's coming, the great king of Bantu people. So this video is in English. I want to thank all brothers and sisters, English-speaking brothers and sisters who watch our videos. Unfortunately, these videos are in French. We are revealing many secrets to our people. Our first YouTube channel was a great channel with many subscribers. It was cut down by the so-called Jews who was fighting against us, fighting against the truth. But we can't stop revealing the great secret to our people. The Bible is the book of Bantu people. Bantu are located behind the river of Ethiopia, according to the book of Isaiah 18 chapter from 1 to 7, and Zephaniah the third chapter from 10 to 20. So we are revealing many secrets to our people that our people must know who we are. And these secrets are really great secrets, but it is all in English, in French. So we want to show you how to translate in English our video. So we're going to show you how to do it in English. It is not perfect, but for you just to get understanding. We are preparing videos in English. It's going to take us time because we have many secrets to reveal in French. We will do it, but meantime, we want you to understand, to get some understanding of what we're saying. These are great secrets. Great secrets revealed to us by Kongo, the angel, the archangel known as Michael in your Bible. We got the secret directly from the angel who deliver his people from the captivity of Egypt. So these are great secrets we are revealing to our people in French. So we want you to get understanding of this, how to do it. So you go to YouTube. This is our page, main page, Tiba Malonga Official. We got other pages. If you click here, you find many of our channel. The first one is Nabi Tiba Malonga. You can come here. You got Nabi Tiba Malonga. Okay. You click here the last video.
Quoi? Vous ne savez pas que le cube magique est incomplet.
So, how to translate, for example, this video? Automatically, thanks to Google, you go to CC here. I will put it closer. So you go to CC here, CC. You click to CC here. Once you click here, you go to the setting. You go to the setting. You go to subtitle. You click on Substyle here. After clicking on Substyle, you will find language. So you go down, you go to Auto Translate. You click on Auto Translate. You will find many language. You select any language of your choice. Okay? You get down to look for English. You come here. You got English here. You select English. Sorry, yes, you select English here. Once you select English, you see it is in English now. So now you can play our video. Tac.
Tournable you dans play. La cuisine africaine.
You got translation automatically.
Nombre plein, qu'il s'agisse du ndolé camerounais, okay. De la sauce graine ivoirienne ou du tiboudjien sénégalais.
So now you got translation automatically. You got translation automatically. It's not that perfect, but For the time being, we are preparing. We want you to do it to get some understanding. Okay? Once we will do, we will make some videos in English as well. So, we do many things in French. We are not many. And we want your understanding to let us prepare English-speaking videos. So for the time being, it's just a solution for the time being. Thank you for your understanding. May the Most High bless you and fully bless your families. Okay? We thank you very much for watching the videos. Thank you. Be blessed. You and your families. Matondo.
If someone were to guess as to what event had most greatly impacted sub-Saharan African demography in the past 2,000 years, they'd probably state the slave trade or European colonization. However, long before the Europeans or Middle Easterners or Chinese had visited the continent of Africa, major changes were taking place. The people of sub-Saharan Africa are divided into a few major groups, but the largest of which would definitely be the Bantu peoples, a loose conglomeration of nations stretching from Cameroon to Mozambique. But this, of course, was not always the case, and the rise of the Bantu people is a fascinating but generally unknown subject to many Westerners. The Bantu languages today are a branch of the Niger-Congo language family, a truly massive grouping that also takes up most of West Africa, and I will admit that I've been guilty of incorrectly lumping them together in the past. However, the Bantu are definitely distinct for a number of reasons, and today we're going to discuss the expansion of the Bantu throughout Africa and the various empires and modern-day nations that have descended from this event. The Jin migrated from Taiwan. But who exactly were the native peoples of this region of Africa before the arrival of the Bantus? There were many diverse groups in Central, Southern, and East Africa when the Bantus arrived, and although the exact distribution of peoples is not entirely clear, Central Africa was mostly inhabited by Pygmy peoples, most of Southern and East Africa by the Khoisan, and the Nilotes inhabited parts of East Africa as well. The Pygmy people are noteworthy for their extremely small stature when compared to other Africans, with the various Pygmy groups still existing in the interior of the Congo, although they no longer retain their original language, instead speaking Bantu languages with a large amount of influence from the pre-Bantu Pygmy languages, and even to this day, the average Pygmy is less than 4'10". The Khoisan have inhabited southern Africa for a mind-boggling amount of time, with some estimating that they've been in the Kalahari Desert for well over 100,000 years, and they are genetically and physically very distinct from Bantus and other Africans. The Khoisan still exist on the southern tip of Africa near the Cape of Good Hope, and some language isolates in East Africa have been classified as Khoisan, although their inclusion is dubious and requires further analysis. The Nilotic peoples possibly inhabited the majority of modern Uganda, Kenya, and Tanzania, although they are still in great abundance in South Sudan and parts of the previous three. They're notable for having nearly pitch-black skin, as well as being some of the tallest people in the world. As I've mentioned in previous videos, the average Nilote is over 6'1", giving a stark contrast to the neighboring Pygmy people of the Congo. Now, the Bantu expansion did not entirely eliminate these people from existence. As I've mentioned, they still do exist in pockets and regions in modern Bantu territory, and additionally, it was very common for the incoming Bantus to mix with these various groups during their march southeast, and hence, many Bantu may have significant admixture from the previous peoples. For instance, in South Africa, the Xhosa people, I hope I'm saying that right, a Bantu group most closely related to the Zulu, have on average 30% Khoisan admixture, and many from Kenya and Uganda might also have Nilotic admixture, and additionally some might even have Cushitic admixture from the neighboring Horn of Africa. The Bantu established many empires and kingdoms along the way of their expanse, including the Congo Kingdom, the Empire of Great Zimbabwe, and possibly most famously the Zulu Kingdom, one of the last independent African kingdoms to be annexed by a European power. There are currently 20 countries with a Bantu majority in Africa today, with around 300 to 600 individual Bantu ethnic groups and languages throughout these countries, and I'm going to name all of them for you right now in alphabetical order. No, I'm just kidding, but let's go ahead and talk about some of the more noteworthy groups in the continent. And since many of these countries don't have an ethnic or linguistic census, it is a little difficult to determine the exact distribution of people, with the area being one of the most linguistically diverse in the world. Because some languages may be mutually intelligible with each other, they may or may not be considered the same ethnic group. For instance, in Rwanda and Burundi in East Africa, the dominant language is Rwanda-Rundi, spoken by some 20 million people. However, the major groups in both countries are the Hutus and Tutsis, both of which speak a dialect of Rwanda-Rundi, yet are considered two very distinct peoples. Some of the groups with a more concrete identity are the Xhosa and Zulu of South Africa, who number around 8 and 12 million people respectively, along with 10 million Shona people in Zimbabwe and Mozambique. Also, keep in mind that because of the borders of the colonial era, many ethnic groups might be spread across multiple countries, while other groups that were previously at odds with each other might have been boxed into the same territory, leading to a bit of a conundrum for the modern people of these countries. The Swahili coast in East Africa has been greatly influenced by many different outside powers, being the only Bantu region where the dominant religion is Islam. Arab traders had been visiting the Swahili coast for well over 1,000 years, and even ancient Greek and Chinese cartographers were aware of its existence. After the death of Muhammad in the 7th century, many merchants and traders from Arabia, Oman, and the Hadramaut settled in this region, and the resulting trade language became known as Swahili, which is fundamentally a Bantu language, however, is occasionally written in the Arabic script, especially in Zanzibar and the Comoros Islands, and has a significant number of loanwords from Arabic, and to a lesser extent, Persian. Swahili has since become the lingua franca of East Africa, and although the number of people that can be classified as ethnically Swahili is only a few million, the majority of Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda have learned Swahili as a second language, numbering close to 80 million people, making it by far the most extensively spoken Bantu language. It would take around 2,000 years for the Bantu to finally reach the edges of the continent after their great trek through the jungles of the Congo, with many historians estimating that the Bantu people may have reached the southern coast of South Africa a mere 1,500 years ago, although the Cape was generally only inhabited by Khoisan peoples at the time of European contact. However, this was not the end for Bantu expansion, as there are many people with full or partial Bantu ancestry outside of this region of Africa. There is, of course, the huge African diaspora in the Americas, mostly in the United States, the Caribbean, and Brazil, although only around 20% of the Black American genome is of Bantu origin, and similar percentages for the Afro-Caribbean people in English-speaking countries, seeing how most of the slaves brought to North America were from West Africa, not Central Africa. However, a much higher proportion of Black Brazilians' DNA is of Bantu origin rather than West African, as many of the slaves that were brought to Brazil, which was a Portuguese colony, were from Angola or Mozambique, which were also Portuguese colonies. There are also moderate numbers of Africans descended from Bantu slaves around the Persian Gulf, such as in southern Iran, Iraq, and Oman, who were brought to the region in the 8th century AD by the Abbasid Caliphate from East Africa, as well as a small community in Karnataka and Gujarat in India known as Sidis. Although they do not speak a Bantu language, virtually the entire population of Madagascar off the coast of Southeast Africa have Bantu DNA from Africans that migrated to the island and mixed with Austronesians from Southeast Asia, as well as Arab, Portuguese, Chinese, and Indian traders to a lesser extent. And the Malagasy language, which is decidedly Austronesian in origin, has a large amount of influence from Bantu languages. Additionally, the small island nations of Mauritius, Reunion, and Seychelles in the Indian Ocean also have large mixed-race populations, mostly of Bantu stock, and the Chagosians from the island of Chagos, now known as the British Indian Ocean Territory, are also of partial Bantu origin. Although the largest genetic contribution to the South African Cape Coloureds is of Khoisan stock, a significant amount of their DNA is from Bantu sources, as well as the other mixed-race groups in the area. There's also a growing diaspora of more recent immigrants from Bantu countries all around the world, as well as internal migration within the region of Bantu inhabitants, with there being an especially large influx into South Africa from neighboring countries in recent years. Overall, Bantu peoples total over 400 million people, about 40% of the continent of Africa, and 6% of the human species, making up an extremely vast and diverse assortment of people, stretching from many areas of the African continent and many countries. Oh, and fun fact, the highest proportion of albinos in the world is actually among Bantu people located around Lake Victoria in the middle of Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda, with there being around 150,000 albinos in the region who have more or less formed their own communities due to ostracism caused by local superstition. The Bantu expansion really did completely change the face of Africa as we know it, and without this event, the countries and people of sub-Saharan Africa would have looked very different than they do now. Go ahead and let me know your thoughts on the Bantu expansion and the many Bantu nations and people that inhabit Africa and beyond. And as always, thanks for watching, everyone. It's been Mason, and I'll see you next time.